This year, we want to raise £250,000. Yes, you heard right, £250,000. How will the funds be used? Funds raised during our Call to Compassion campaign will support dairy farmers in Nepal, Zambia, and India, improve livelihoods and provide shelter for Mauritanian lepers, improve nutrition for tea estate workers in rural communities in Sri Lanka. They will also improve women's health outcomes and immunization in Nepal, and strengthen migrant rights protection in Thailand. Advocacy for women's rights both in the UK and developing countries will also benefit from these funds. And we are pleased to announce that once again, up to 10% of funds raised will go to supporting high impact projects right here in the UK.
Give now. We can't do it without you. Your support makes our work possible. Your generous gift now will have a direct and life-saving impact worldwide. So to donate, click on the link in the bio, scan the QR code, or visit adra.org.uk/donate.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath, everyone. The ADRA, Adventist Development and Relief Agency's annual appeal continues until the 27th of April. So I just encourage you, if you're not aware of some of the projects that are currently being funded by ADRA, to have a look at the newsletter. There's an Impact News, which you can get up on the back table, and highlight some of the great projects, such as helping to educate some of the conflict-affected children in Myanmar, and also dairy development in Zambia, which is helping a lot of the women there to earn money. So there are some fantastic projects which ADRA is helping to fund at the moment. So I'd encourage you all to make yourself familiar with some of these. We also have some coin savers up the back too, if you have kids and the kids want to collect some pound coins. You can get one of these and they can collect 12 coins, which can then be contributed to ADRA as well. Thank you for all of your current donations and contributions, and please do consider making a contribution if you haven't already. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nick. Thank you for continuing to promote ADRA. We appreciate that. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. It's lovely to have you all here. It's lovely to have our online audience. Just before we start an in-house bit relating to next Sabbath and the program. So next Sabbath on campus, there will be an Ellen White symposium taking place. It starts on Friday evening here in the church. So it will start at 6 o'clock here. So you're welcome to join the symposium here. On Sabbath morning, the program will start in the gym at 8:45. I know, it's early. Bring your breakfast, eat it in the car on your way here. If the weather's good, we can bring a picnic blanket, have it outdoors, but it starts at 8:45. The 11 o'clock service, we normally start at 11:15. However, next Sabbath, the service will start in the gym at 11 o'clock. All right, so come early to secure seats and all of that. Please use all the parking on campus. There is parking right here next to the church. There is parking next to Salisbury Hall, and there will be parking down at the gym. The program will continue throughout the day at 2 o'clock, and it will go on in the afternoon, and there will be a program on Sunday morning starting at 9 o'clock. So I'm just flagging everyone, it's a big weekend, it's a long weekend. Just make a note of the times. If you are uncertain, come and talk to me, and I'll gladly give you details. Thank you very much for your attention. We look forward to the worship today, which will be led by our Newbold students. So thank you very much, and thank you for leading us, not only here in the building, but also online. Thank you.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. I hope you've all had a lovely week. The weather has slowly but surely been improving. So we are the one-year mission students, and we're so excited to be leading out in worship today. This is actually one of our last Sabbaths here, so we want to make it one of the best ones yet. So let's start with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for waking us up this morning. Please bless us as we come to worship you today. In your name I pray, amen. Over this past week at Newbold, we were blessed with an amazing pastor, Dr. Joel Gregory, who spoke to some of the students on Wednesdays and Thursday. And one of the verses that he spoke on really stood out to me. It was Philippians 1, verse 21. For to me, living is Christ, and to die is to gain. And it made me start to think, how amazing is God? How amazing is his love for us? We're so blessed to have so many reasons as to why we should keep thanking him. So let's stand this morning as we sing 10,000 Reasons.
Has looked like, but I'm so glad that all of you have made it here today to worship with us. And when we look back over what the Lord has done for us, there's nothing but good things that we can say how God has been in our lives. Please join us as we sing, Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Savior. And as we have washed, we have come and congregated this morning to give thanks for walking with us, for journeying with us, for encouraging us, for giving us courage, for giving us comfort through the journeys and experiences of life in the past week. We really want to give ourselves to you totally and say thank you. Receive our thanksgiving, receive our worship. Because you alone are God, and we are agreeing on this, that there is nobody like you. There is nobody like you. So Lord, as we continue to worship you this morning, we would like to acknowledge the fact that despite our best intentions as human beings, we do not always live up to the desired outcomes of our life. We have sinned against you. We have sinned against one another. We have sinned against ourselves. And we are coming to seek forgiveness. We are coming to seek mercy. And we are coming to seek pardon. We thank you because you are a God who forgives, a God who shows mercy and grace, and a God who embraces us even in our brokenness. And Lord, we want to, just as we have started in acknowledging your presence and your power and your manifested goodness in our life and how you've journeyed with us, we recognize that in our midst, as we have gathered as a church, we have got some needs which we would like to bring before you this morning. There are some among us who are broken because they have lost loved ones and they are mourning and they are crying. And we would like to ask you, Lord, to comfort them. And we'd like to pray as well for one of our members who has passed away, Brit, and her family, and all of the people in her sphere of influence, Lord, that you give them comfort and you give them strength in this time of loss. There may be some people in our midst who would have loved to come and worship with us, but they can't. Maybe because they are ill, or maybe because they've got heavy burdens that they are carrying, or some things are happening in their life that we can't even begin to know. The atrocities and the pains and sufferings of life, there are so many that we can't even begin to mention. As we have met together as your daughters and sons this morning, we would like to lift them up to you and ask that wherever they are, may you give them comfort. May you provide healing. May you provide strength. And to families who are caring for loved ones who are ill, we pray that you give them the encouragement and the peace and the hope that they need. We would like to remember our children who are away at the moment, the pathfinders as well as the adventurers in the Netherlands, and ask that, Lord, as they are there and as they go through the Bible experience, the greatest thing that we pray for is not just for their protection, but that they may come to meet the God of the Bible, and that in everything that they are doing as they are learning the Bible, they may encounter Christ and find you to be who you are, and they may grow up to know you and to love you, that this experience may speak very positively and powerfully into their experiences with you as they grow up and journey on. And Lord, we would also like to thank you for the children who've been brought or who have been born into the church family in the past week. We thank you for the gift of children, and we want to commit the parents, both new parents as well as older parents, parents of little ones, parents of teenagers, parents of young adults, parents of adult children, and ask that you continue to provide the wisdom and the strength to all parents to do the job of parenting, learning from you, the most merciful and gracious parent. And Lord, we thank you this morning for the young people who are leading in worship. We thank you for the time that they have spent at New Board during the program of year in mission. And as a church, we want to dedicate them to you as they leave New Board into the next phase and stages of their life where you're calling them. We pray that you may pave a path ahead of them. We pray that your spirit may lead them. We pray that they may hear a word saying, "This is the way, walk ye in it." And that the time that they have spent here at New Board may enrich their experiences of knowing you, and that they can go wherever you send them and be representatives of the kingdom of God in a true, authentic, and relevant way in the spaces where you send them. Thank you, Lord. There is a lot that's happening in the world that we can't even begin to mention all the things. But thank you because your spirit is always at work. You never leave us alone. You never forsake us. You are faithful. And we thank you for this great faithfulness that sustains us through life. And as we give in the next few moments in a small way to say thank you, returning to you what is yours, but also giving to say thank you for what you have done and how generously you treat us, we pray that you may receive our offerings, you may receive our tithes, but above all else, we recommit ourselves to you and say that may you receive our hearts, and that our experiences with you, our journeying with you, the presence of the Spirit may be something that we encounter on a day-by-day basis. We ask for all this in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
I would like to invite the deacons forward to take up the offering.
look at those beautiful boys and girls. Thank you very much for being here. That's it. Have a seat. Have a seat. Excellent. All right. The morning started with this. Oh, mommy, please. Roy, mama said, I've already told you no. But mommy, please. I said no. Stop arguing with me. But mommy, please. Jack, his friend, his neighbor, wants us to go to the fair. Roy, mama said, I told you once, I told you 1,000 times, you and Jack cannot go to the fair. Now, what's a fair? That's when a whole lot of rides come into the neighborhood. You know what I mean? There's wheels and boats and a whole lot of games are out there. Now, Jack and Roy had made a plan. They wanted to go to the fair. But mommy said, no. But Roy would not understand no. He said, Mom, he's my friend. He's going to go and I'm going to be left behind. And Mom said, Roy, I said no for 2 reasons. Are you ready? Reason number one. You were sick just a couple of days ago. You're still coughing and you're not ready to go out there. And reason number two. The rides on the fair are fairly old and rickety and squeaky. They're not just that well maintained. Anything can go wrong. Mom, there are a whole lot of boys and girls. Nothing's gonna go wrong. Roy, mama said, up to your bedroom, do your homework. And Roy pulled this face. I know. And he went upstairs. He got to his desk and to his chair and boom, slumped himself on his chair. And he started doing homework like this. Because he wanted to go where? To the fair. And mom said, I don't know what mom was doing, but Roy figured she wouldn't notice that he would come down the stairs. So he smuggled himself very, very quietly down the stairs when mom did not notice and ran out the back door to the next door neighbor, Jack, his friend. And Jack said, come on, where have you been? We got to go. The day is going. No, I can't go. Mom said, no. Roy, you can do it. No, I can. But I'm going to have fun on my own. That's not possible. You've got to, because my mom's, no, she's not going to know. And when she finds out, she's going to get over it. Please leave me alone. No, please come with me. Oh, and Jack, oh, you know how friends can be pushy sometimes? Now that was Jack for you. Before he knew it, Roy's legs, instead of going back to his house and upstairs to do his, went the exact opposite direction into the park where the fair was. Now, the boys had a favorite one. It was a roundabout type of ride. I'm sure you saw them. They got all sorts of animals that go up and down and you can ride on them. Do you know what I'm talking about? They're, I don't know, a whole lot of things. So boys chose horses. So they paid the ticket, and then they climbed up there, and they each found a horse, and the horse was going up and down, and the whole thing was going round and round. They loved it. They had an amazing time. They loved it so much that they actually paid to go again. So they went the second time. Whew, I'd be dizzy just thinking about it. No, they were not. They had a good time. And they loved it so much, they paid the tickets to go a third time. On the same horses, up and down and round they went. And that is when they noticed that the music started going a little bit faster than normal. And so did the horses. It wasn't just up and down gently. It started going up and down, faster and faster. And the ride started spinning faster and faster. And then they noticed the man who was looking after all of this, running around, not knowing what to do. He went to the engine room, and then he went to the switches over there. And then before they knew it, that roundabout ride fell apart. Boys, girls, moms, dads, whoever was riding on the roundabout went flying everywhere. People had broken arms and broken legs, and oh, it was blood everywhere, and cables and wires and wood and animals, wooden animals. But now they're all dead. Everywhere. And everybody, ambulances came, and everybody went to the hospital, including Roy and his friend Jack. They had bruises, and it was painful. Can anybody tell me how you think the discussion went when Mom came to the hospital?
Sad.
Sad. I'll take that. How do you think it went, you young ones?
Scolding.
All right. Tell me more. Come on, you're old enough to know. Hold on. Oh, let's see, Uncle Christian, if we can activate this microphone. That's untold. Let's see if we can. Are you ready? So let's see how that conversation would have gone.
She would have said, "Why did you go?" He would have gone, "I don't know." And she would have said, "Well, you must know." And he would have gone, "I don't know."
He should be the storyteller. That's what I think. How do you think the conversation went there? Do you think people were happy? Do you think Mom was happy for Roy's choice? Definitely no. No parent likes to see their children hurt. I tell you this. No parent likes to see their children hurt. There was a lot of sadness. There were a lot of words that were not even spoken. They may have been thought, but not spoken. But I tell you one lesson that Roy learned that day. No matter who your friends are, if they push you to do something wrong, you should what? Not do it. Stand up for that which is right. Because if you do something wrong, the chances are somebody is going to get hurt. Are you with me? Now, moms and dads will tell you to do and not do things, and you are going to go, "Oh, but why? You mean, you don't know, you're spoiling my fun." But moms and dads know what's right for you. Listen to moms and dads, or else somebody is going to get hurt. Do you think your parents love you? Okay, let me try that again. I'm very sure your parents love you. Yeah? Thank you. Whew. We saved that one. They love you very much, and they want the best for you. I know it's hard sometimes to listen, but would you be willing to make an effort to listen to moms and dads? Anybody who's willing to listen to moms and dads, put your hand up. All right, put your hand up. There you go, a lot of boys and girls. Let those cameras see those hands up. Parents, take a snap, something or another, so you have proof. All right, there are a lot of boys and girls who want to. Almost all. Thank you. We need help to listen to moms and dads. Can we ask God to help us? Come on, one hand, two hands. Put your hands together and eyes closed. Dear God, forgive us because sometimes, like Roy, we do our own thing. Help us to listen to our parents because they know what's right. Teach us how to listen to you because you know what's right for us. Protect us from harm and danger because sometimes we get into trouble. May we always come home to mom and dad. May we always come home to you and let them love us. Let them help us heal if we get hurt, and teach us how to listen better. We thank you for our boys, and we thank you for our girls. Bless them today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much for listening so nicely. Now, I know there are worksheets for you if you go right at the back of the church. Thank you. Today is a very special day because a young family has asked that we dedicate their child. So I'd like to invite Andrea and Christina to join me here, please. And baby Samuel. All right, now give the cameras a chance to capture this beauty. There we go, and the church said, thank you, I was hoping for that. That's beautiful, you're adorable, son. Don't worry, you'll look back on this on YouTube back in time and you'll say, oh no, was that me? Christina, Andre, you celebrate, you're happy, and the most important bit is that you celebrate not only on your own and your family and your friends, but you want God to be part of your life and part of Samuel's life. And we give thanks together with you for that. There's a Bible text I would like to read. It's written in Isaiah. It says, here am I and the children the Lord has given me. We are signs and symbols in Israel from the Lord Almighty who dwells on Mount Zion. You and I as parents is one thing, but there's an awesome responsibility to taking our children with us when it comes to God. So today, we want to commit you to do whatever you can to raise him up in such a way that he learns about God and he learns how to respond to God and follow him. Yeah? To do that, I will invite the whole church to stand up, please, as we have a prayer together. Dear God, we thank you very much for the gift that Samuel is to his family, to his parents and his extended family. We thank you for the joy he brings. We thank you for the smiles he brings. We thank you that he's a healthy young lad. Dear God, today, please accept our thanks as a church for the gift of life. We thank you for Andre and Christina. They stand before you willing to commit themselves to do everything in their power to raise up Samuel to love you, to raise him up in such a way that he recognizes you in his life. We thank you very much for their commitment, and we pray over them, not only for today, but for the rest of their lives. Give them wisdom, give them health and strength to be able to do that which is necessary for Samuel. Dear God, we as a church, we are a church family. No parent can bring a child up on their own. It takes more than that. Bring to our attention the things we do to support this lovely family and the other young families in our church. May we serve. May we teach. May we lead by example in such a way that the children in this church will have role models. Dear God, we dedicate Samuel to you. We pray over him. And we ask that your presence will never depart from him. This is our prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You did well, baby. Well done. Christina, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Andre?
Thank you.
Well done. Well done. Thank you, baby. We have a little gift. And our team have arranged the display in such a way that it contains toys. So this is Samuel's little gift from Jesus. There you go. Because Jesus loves the little children.
Thank you.
It's amazing to celebrate life together, and something that is extremely beautiful about life is that each morning of life to which we wake up is full of God's grace, and that grace sustains every day of our lives, and that grace is amazing. So let's stand up together and sing Amazing Grace.
The scripture reading today is taken from Matthew 16, 24 to 27. Matthew chapter 16, verses 24 to 27. And it reads, "Then Jesus said to his disciples, 'Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what they have done.'" May the Lord bless this reading.
We're very blessed in this church to have amazing talent. And today it was our students. So thank you very much for leading so beautifully so far. We appreciate Danilo's effort in holding it all together. Thank you. Now, I would like to put up on the screen the names of 10 memorable individuals. You can find these names in each one of our Adventist families. Those names are held in very high esteem by every single one of us. And here are the 10 names: Shamua, Shafat, Igal, Palti, Gadiel, Gadi, Amiel, Setur, Nachbi, and Geuel. 10 names. You can find plenty of those in each one of our families. They are duplicates here in the church. Am I right? No. Somebody's not reading their Bibles. To put these names in perspective, allow me please to add two more, and perhaps then you will recognize them. Does the list make sense now? Those are the names of the 12 spies which Moses sent out into the land of Canaan on their first arrival on the border of the promised land. So I would like to invite you, please, to take your Bibles, turn them on to Numbers 13. Numbers 13. The passage we're going to focus on today comes in the context of the promise God made to the people of Israel. Many, many years ago, God called a man named Abraham and said, "Come out, and I am going to give you this land."
That was the promise God made to Abraham. And then from generation to generation, that promise was passed on and on and on and on until God intervened powerfully and rescued the people of Israel out of the hands of the Egyptians with a mighty hand and brought them all the way to the border of Canaan. And Numbers 13, which is the passage that I just referred to, and you need to keep it on, we'll read from it, finds the people of Israel a couple of years later right there on the border, ready to cross it and inherit it. Generations lived in the hope that they will see this promise being fulfilled. Generations of parents told stories to their children and said, God promised we will have that land. And they stood right there ready to take possession of it. So in Numbers 13, right at the beginning, first couple of verses, God says, pick 12 people and send them out there fact-finding. Or if you really want, fact-checking. Verse 2, send men to scout out the country of Canaan that I'm giving to the people of Israel. Send one man from each tribe, each one a tried and true leader in the tribe. Remember that. And then verses 18, 19, and 20, he says, let them assess the people. Let them observe the land. Let them describe the towns. Let them bring samples back for you all. And then if you continue in Numbers 13, verses 27, 8, and 9, you will see that they come back and they say, the land is flowing with milk and honey. And then they bring samples along. In verse 23, you see this described. Now try to imagine it. When they arrived at the Eshkol Valley, they cut off a branch. Listen to this. The details are important. With a single cluster of grapes. It took two men to carry it slung on a pole. Can you picture that? Now, when I grew up, back when I was a child, I grew up with a little Bible story, illustrated Bible story. And it had black squares divided in four. And it had stick men and women drawn on it. That's what we grew up with, okay? That was our Bible story diet. And I remember clearly those two stick men with a pole and a whole lot of grapes hanging on it. I love grapes. There's a particular one that I love. When I grew up in Romania and went to the countryside, anybody who had those grapes 100 meters before you hit the garden, you could smell it. Ah! Anybody knows what I'm talking about? Yes? Unique. I've never seen a cluster of grapes that you needed two people to carry on a pole. The land is flowing with milk and honey. They send spies to check that the country is everything that God told them it would be. And they came back with impressive stories. They wanted confirmation that the promise of God was absolutely real. And what do you know? Can you imagine the pressure? Can you imagine the expectation? Can you imagine the excitement in the camp when these guys made their way back? And then the sample, the grapes. God's promise is real. So what's the problem then? What holds them from moving from the shores of the river into the promised land? What stops them from enjoying the promise of God? What stops them from seeing the promise of God being fulfilled in their lives? What is the problem? Now, if you read later on, after the grapes are described, in verse 28, you find the following. The only thing is the people. The only thing is the people who live there are fierce. Their cities are huge and well fortified. Worse yet, we saw descendants of the giant Anak. And they don't stop there. The Amalekites are spread out in the Negev, in the hills. Hittites and Jebusites and Amorites hold the hill country, and the Canaanites are established on the Mediterranean Sea and along the Jordan. They are at the edge of God's promise, and they have a crisis of belief. Can you imagine? You can smell it. You can taste it. You can see it. And they refuse to carry on. They suddenly stopped believing that God is able to carry them across. And you know what's sad? God had just liberated them from the hands of the Egyptians, which held them in captivity for 400 years. 10 plagues, remember that? God parted the Red Sea and drowned the Egyptian army behind them. God revealed himself on top of the mountain and gave them rules and regulations to order their lives. God was present in their midst in a cloud of fire in the night and a cloud to shade them during the day. And they get up there at the edge of God's promise, and all they can see are giants. Verse 30, Caleb interrupted. He called for silence because everybody was moaning. And then he said, let's go up and take the land now. We can do it. But the others said, and I want you to notice this, we cannot attack those people. They're way stronger than we are. And then verse 32 tells you, in all translations, they spread scary rumors amongst the people of Israel. They said, we scouted out the land from one end to the other. It's a land that swallows people whole. Did you get that? A land that swallows people whole. Everybody we saw was huge. Not only that, we even saw the giants. No wonder it took two of them to carry a cluster of grapes. Alongside them, we felt like grasshoppers, and they looked down on us as if we were grasshoppers. The report is good, but there is difference of opinion in amongst the spies when it comes to the promise of God. And you have these two realities. You have those, most of them, who consider the threat to outweigh the promise. But you have two of them who consider the promise is capable to outweigh the threat. But you see what we do when negativity sets in our lives. We begin to imagine that things are much worse than they truly are. Because those who cannot trust in God to overcome the challenge they're faced with, they will generally exaggerate the challenge to make their refusal more plausible. It is a land that swallows people whole. Did you hear that? They gave a bad report, and the purpose of that bad report was to postpone or to hesitate, to resist, to wait, to digress, or to go back. Their unbelief, their disconnection from God, their broken relationship with God always waits for a more convenient season. And tell me if that's not true of us too. The grapes are there, the proof, and yet is not enough. There are two problems that I see in this passage and I see in our lives as well. The first one is a distorted self-image. 10 of the spies looked around and they saw themselves as grasshoppers. Not only did they perceive themselves to be grasshoppers, they were willing to risk the fate of the people they represented because they had a self-image which was distorted. They saw giants and they bet their futures on it. 12 of them came so close to God's promises. They were invited to investigate, and their observations could not be any more different. Some saw themselves as grasshoppers in the eyes of man, but two saw the giants as grasshoppers in the eyes of God. The facts were the same. They all agreed the grapes are delicious. But most got stuck on the details of the cities being fortified and the people living there being the descendants of giants. And out of 12 spies, leaders in their tribes, 10 said, we cannot do it. But 2 said, we can. Let me tell you about those 2. In verse 30, Caleb interrupts Moses. Now, it takes a little bit of courage to do that, am I right? I mean, you don't mess around with Moses. He's God's appointed instrument to bring the people out of Egypt. Caleb interrupts Moses and he says, let us go up and take the land now. We can do it. Because when faced with giants, he stands out and sees opportunities, not challenges. Let me give you another interesting fact about his friend Joshua. In Joshua chapter 2 verse 9, Joshua describes the situation when the spies, they roam around for 40 years. And after 40 years, it's Joshua's turn as a leader to send spies out there. Let me tell you what the spies report in terms of what the Canaanites truly thought of them. Rahab comes up to the spies who are hiding on top of the roof. And she says in Joshua chapter 2 verse 9, all who live in this country are melting in fear because of you. And in verse 11, when we heard of it, of what God has done, our hearts melted in fear and everyone's courage failed because of you. For the Lord your God is God in heaven above and on the earth below. They saw themselves as grasshoppers because that was how they viewed themselves. If you were to ask the giants what they saw, they would have seen their God, the Israelite God, and shook in their boots. But if you got that self-distorted image, then you're going to view yourself like this instead of viewing yourself as who God sees you to be. Some people, consider that the threat outweighs the promise of God. But Joshua and Caleb, who have the true image, a good self-image, they look at the promise and it says, it far exceeds the threat that lies ahead. There's a second challenge we have, and that is giants. We have the wrong theology. They took their eyes off God and they placed it on the giants. 10 of the 12 spies which went out to explore the promised land, they forgot the promise that God made. They forgot what God has done. They forgot his faithfulness. They forgot that every single day God was giving them bread from heaven. He fed them and sustained them. They get out there and they see a challenge. And they, instead of looking up there, they look back. They want to go back to Egypt if you ask them. You know what they say? If you flick over to the next chapter or turn the page, chapter 14. All the people in verse 2 of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The entire community was in it. Listen to what they said. Why did we not die in Egypt or in the wilderness? Why has God brought us to this country to kill us? Do you hear them? God has just picked them up from the slums of Egypt, rescued them, cared for them, saved them from the hands of the Egyptians, planted them on the shores of the promised land. And they wonder, why did God bring us here to kill us? Our wives and children are about to become plunder. Why don't we just head back to Egypt and do it right now? The power of God is present in their lives, and yet they think that God wants to kill them. Can you imagine? It's a tricky question. All they can see are giants because they had the wrong view of God. They are afraid of their own God, And when you are afraid of your own God, you're going to be afraid of everybody around you. They were part of the church community, and yet nothing God did before counted any longer for them. Contrast that with the right theology. Numbers 14, verse 5. This is the response of the leaders. Moses and Aaron fell face down in front of the whole Israelite assembly gathered there. Joshua and Caleb, they who were amongst those who explored the land, tore their clothes and said this. This is the right theology to the entire Israelites assembly. The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. At least they all agreed on that. Now listen to verse 8 in chapter 14. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into that land. He will lead us, a land flowing with milk and honey, and he will give it to us. Do not rebel against the Lord. Do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. When we fear God, we are going to fear anything and everything around us. Do you hear me? Have the wrong theology, and you will be stuck on the shores of River Jordan. Joshua knew a completely different reality. If you were to flick through your Bibles to Exodus chapter 33, verse 11, it's easy to remember, 3:3:1:1. You will find the following. The Lord would speak to Moses face to face. I still can't fathom that. As one speaks to a friend. Just let that picture. Then Moses, when they were done chatting, he would return to the camp, but his young aide Joshua, son of Nun, the same Joshua, he did not leave the tent. You want the right theology? Do come to New Bold and study. That helps. There is nothing that can substitute time with God. Nothing. No amount of knowledge, no amount of church services, or sermons or books will be able to substitute standing in that tent and having an intimate relationship with God. So is there any doubt that when Joshua speaks in front of the entire assembly, he says, "The Lord is with us"? He knew it when God is there because he experienced it regularly. Joshua and Caleb saw giants just like everybody else. But while themselves, they saw in themselves being grasshoppers in the eyes of the giants, Joshua and Caleb saw the giants as grasshoppers in the eyes of God. They knew it experientially that the God who led them that far would not abandon them on the edge of the promised land. They knew that God loves uneven battles because when he wins, he gets the glory. Joshua and Caleb knew that every promise has a challenge. And they knew what Paul discovered many, many years later on. If God is for us, if you read chapters 13 and 14 well, you will notice that God features in Joshua's view of circumstances. However, God does not feature in the reports of any of the other 10 spies. The only time they reference God is when they say, "He brought us here to kill us." You ask Joshua and Caleb, and they will tell you a completely different story about our God. God's promises drive us forward, not back. Fearing God, living our relationship with God, drives us back, not forward. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. So if we are to apply the lessons learned from this story to our life, I would like to suggest that we apply them on three levels. First of all, one could take this passage and apply it literally, and I strongly advise against it. Because I would hope that after millennia of cruel fighting in the Middle East, no one should be tempted to apply this story literally. Let's go out there and take the land no matter what. For enough, more than enough blood has been shed in the name of conquering Canaan and the promised land. And that is still making the news today, tragically. And that's all I'm going to say about that. We cannot read this story literally. But there is another one. We can read this story in a personal way if you want. Because every one of us is on a personal journey to our own Canaan. God promised things to us in different ways, and we all pursue our own version of the promised land. For most people, the threat outweighs the promise, and they shrink. For some, however, the promise they learn to trust their God can outweigh the threat. We all pursue financial independence. That may be the Canaan promise to one of us. Relational completeness. I'm trying to choose my words carefully. Vocational fulfillment. Personal success in whatever other form. We all pursue our promised land in one way or another. So we can apply this story personally. I remember back in the day when I was a child, I went to school and I grew up in a church. 400, 500 members, beautiful church, amazing church, wonderful, committed Christians who served us and taught us and did sacrificed a lot for us as children to grow in that church. And we owe them being in the church and following God for their commitment to Him. I grew up in that beautiful church, and most of my friends, when it came to school age, they all went to study music. For health reasons, I couldn't. So my parents said, you go and do gymnastics. Don't you think I got what it takes? I had a problem. Because everybody who studied music could come to church on Sabbath and show everybody what they're learning. But I did. I couldn't show people what I was able to do. I was at a disadvantage. But I put my heart into gymnastics. I worked hard. Eventually, we were a class of 30 that dwindled. The numbers dwindled. There were 8 of us. And the opportunity was given to us to actually move from local level to national level so we can compete in gymnastics nationally. And I had a dilemma because on the one hand, I wanted to pursue it just like my friends were pursuing music and were excelling in it. And I wanted to pursue it, but I had a problem. That was my promised land. It was amazing back in the days, communist times. Romania did amazingly well at gymnastics. We were able to compete with the best out there, and very often we won. That was the promised land. But as it was presented to us, my mom and dad sat me down and said, son, you're good at it. You could do well in it. But all competitions are on Sabbath. We can all pursue dreams. We all have our promised lands. And some of them present challenges. Oh, you should figure out by now that I didn't. That's why I became a preacher. There are dreams, there are promises out there, and some of them confront us with significant soul-searching opportunities. You have the wrong self-image, you can land yourself in trouble. You have the wrong picture of God, you can make fatal choices. There are inherent dangers in every one of us pursuing our own promised land, our own Canaan. Can I just mention one such danger that Jesus speaks on? It relates to those for whom financial independence is the goal, is the promised land. Luke 12:15, Jesus said this to them, watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. Do you hear him? And he told them this parable, the ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. You know the story. He thought to himself, what shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, this is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns, build bigger ones, and there I'll store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Retire. No, it says, take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool. This very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourselves? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves but is not rich towards God. We all have our promised lands. We read the promises, we apply them to ourselves. Can I say, be mindful? Because in the case of greed, for example, I have never seen a hired van, enterprise, thrifty, or whatever other name is out there, driving behind the hearse and carrying the goods of the person heading to the cemetery. We cannot take it with us. Make sure the Canaan we pursue is the Canaan God promised us. We can apply this story personally. But perhaps there is a third way in which we can apply this story. And that is spiritually. Because we're all heading for the promised land. Am I right? For most, the threat outweighs the promise. For few, the promise outweighs the threat. Let me make this point. The spiritual... This spiritual journey is not one that is played out in the physical realm. It is a spiritual battle for our souls, for our hearts. The land which is to be inherited is not so much a physical land, it's the reality of living forever with God in an intimate relationship on an earth which is made new. The giants, the spiritual giants I am speaking of, are not the physical giants that Joshua and Caleb and the other unnamed 10 were confronted with. The spiritual giants we are confronting, or we will do well to confront, if you want to look at them historically, they will have 7 or 8 names: pride, greed, lust, envy, gluttony, anger, and laziness. Did you come across those? Or if you want to look at them biblically, Galatians chapter 5 tells us about them. Those spiritual giants we need to fight. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, and witchcraft. Perhaps not so familiar to some of us, but the others would be hatred and discord and jealousy and fits of rage and selfish ambition and dissensions and factions and envy. I need to catch my breath a little bit. And drunkenness and orgies and the like. The biggest battles at the moment are the battles for our hearts, not for our bodies. Let me remind you of the scripture reading which was read very nicely earlier on. Whoever wants to be my disciple, Jesus says, they must deny themselves, take up their cross, follow me. For whoever wants to save their lives will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be? Listen to this. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world and yet forfeit their soul? The battle today is not for physical realities, important and necessary as they are. The battle today is for your heart and for my heart. And in the context of the story of Joshua and Caleb and the other spies, having the right view of God will help us fight the giants that stand before us. Understanding that before the world was even created, God had a desire deep down in his heart to live, to share himself with you and with me. Understanding that even though evil entered the universe, it did not stop God from pursuing that desire. He created the world. He placed us out there and Sabbathed with us. But we said, no, we have better ideas. And we went our own route. We turned our backs on God and turned towards something else. We pursued completely different things. But that did not stop God. And you read your Bible and chapter after chapter, character after character, God reaches out because he cannot contain himself and stay away from the people he loves. And you end up all the way in history to a time when people as stubborn as us will be willing to go to hell itself but not turn back to God. And guess what? When they get there, they see my Lord with his arms stretched out, wide open, ready to embrace anybody who says, I would like a piece of this God. That is the right view of God. You possess that view of God, and we will be able to fight the spiritual giants in our lives. A theology which is steeped in fear is going to drive us to a completely different outcome. A theology steeped in the love and the presence of God in our lives is going to drive us into his arms. In the same context, spiritualizing, if you want the story that we read earlier on, having a right self-image is equally essential. My friends, we stand in the presence of God like Joshua did, and he will smoothen the rough edges we have. Living our lives with God by spending time daily with him will give us the opportunity to be infused with God. Let me ask you this. How would your life be different if you were to spend a tenth of the time you spend working with God? You understand my question? What if we dedicated a tenth of the time we spend out there working, making a living, necessary as it is? What if we were to dedicate that to God? How do you think we would face the spiritual giants in our lives? Do you think we'd be the Joshuas and Calebs? Or do you think we'd be like the other 10 who ran away? I think you know the answer. We come together as a church to reaffirm the right understanding of God and who we truly are in God's eyes. Because, my friends, in God's eyes, you are no grasshopper. Do you hear me? The evil in our lives may make us think that. But if we learn to listen to the voice of God, he will tell us, I see no grasshopper in you. You may, if you listen to the wrong voice, learn to listen to mine. There are spiritual giants which need to be overcome. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world and forfeit their soul? I believe there is a spiritual land to be conquered. There are giants to be overcome. There are cities in our own lives whose walls need to come down. That is the real fight. Here is an insight from my life. I'm making my way through life. And here is a reality that I'm becoming more and more convinced of. God answers a lot of our prayers in the physical realm in order to build sufficient trust in our relationship with him so we can conquer the spiritual giants in our lives. Can I say that again? God answers a lot of our prayers in the physical, the tangible aspects of our lives in order to teach us how to trust him so we can confront the spiritual giants in our hearts. It was true of Abraham. It started with tangible things. And then God led him to the point where he trusted him with everything. It was true of Moses, who tried to do it all by force. And then God revealed himself. And at the end of the day, the two of them spoke face to face with one another. And when Moses' life just expired, God said, I love that man so much, I cannot wait. Come up here with me. It was true of David. It was true of the disciples. It was true of Paul. And it is true of you and me. He answers our physical questions and prayers and grants us promises so we can learn to trust him in matters that relate to our hearts. Do you remember the movie Bruce Almighty? I know, irreverent question. God tells somebody to build an ark. And Morgan Freeman plays God beautifully. And then he meets his wife, who's very upset at the restaurant, and they begin dialoguing. And then God in the movie asks this. Let me ask you something. If somebody prays for patience, you think God gives them patience? Or does he give them the opportunity to be patient? If he prayed for courage, does God give him courage or does he give him the opportunities to be courageous? If someone prayed for the family to be closer, that was the case with them. Do you think God zaps them with warm, fuzzy feelings or does he give them the opportunities to love each other? Our personal physical reality is closely connected with the spiritual reality. God uses one in order to build the other one. Now, I started today with 12 names. 10, not memorable. 2, unforgettable. What came of them? Numbers 14, God was angry. And God said to Moses, how long will these people treat me like dirt? How long will they refuse to trust me? And with all these signs that I have done among them. Moses, in his true style, pleads with God. And in response, here is what God says. Numbers 14:20. God said, I forgive them, honoring your words. But as I live, and as the glory of God fills the whole earth, not a single person of those who saw my glory saw the miracle signs I did in Egypt and the wilderness, and who have tested me over and over and over again, turning a deaf ear to me. Not one of them will set eyes on the land I so solemnly promised to their ancestors. Did you hear that? No one who has treated me with such repeated contempt will see it. In other words, we keep coming to God, praying and asking and for more and more and more, and God gives us because he wants to establish that foundation of relationship to help us in our own spiritual battles. But when it comes to those things, we say, giants. God said, I will honor, I will keep answering, but there will come a time when I will say, this is it. There is nothing more I can give you out there to make you change your mind that is not about these physical realities. It's about our characters. It's about our hearts. It's about our souls that the battle is on. Verse 24, God says, my servant Caleb, that's a different story. He has a different spirit. He follows me passionately. I will bring him into the land that he scouted and his children will inherit it. Then verse 29, this whole generation of grumblers and grousers. Did you hear that? Not one of you will enter the land and make your home there, the firmly and solemnly promised land, except for Caleb and Joshua. Verse 34, that refers to us. You scouted out the land for 40 days. Your punishment will be a year for each day. And so they went in circles for 40 years until every one of them was gone. There are battles to be fought, both in the physical and spiritual realm. There is a God who is able to handle them both. And he calls leaders like you and I to show others how to do it. Here is the most upsetting thing about this story for me. 12 people scouted the land. 10 saw something the other two didn't. But those 10 influenced the rest of the Israelite community. Do you know how the story ends? Notwithstanding what God said to them, the Israelites decided, no, 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 we're going to go and take the land on our own. And they did, and got killed. Your choice influences other people. It's not just about you and God. It has an impact on those around us. So let me say this. The grapes are real. They are real. Both the physical promise as well as the spiritual promise. Grasshoppers? Not for me, thank you very much. Giants? Not for me either. Because I choose to believe in the God who gave the promise. Be the threat as big as it can be, my God's promise will be far greater than the threat that lies ahead, whether it applies to the physical reality or the spiritual one. So here's the question today. Which list will have your name on it? The 10 or the 2? Which one will you be? Because I believe that those of us who experience the deep love of the Father will be at the right theology, will be able to face both physical and spiritual giants and enter the promised land that was given to us. May we be part of that group. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Marcel, for that powerful message. God's promise is real. He won't leave us. And his love for us is very real. Please stand as we sing How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
Love for us, how vast beyond all measure.
God, may we experience this love we just sang about deep in every aspect of our lives. Help us to trust you, open our eyes, reveal yourself to us to see the way in which you keep your promises to us all. But above it all, I pray that as we work in this physical realm of ours, you will help us, our characters, to become more like yours. Teach us how to love as you did. Teach us how to serve as you did. Teach us how to be more like you. Teach us to be Joshua's and Caleb's, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you all for coming today. Hope you have enjoyed the rest of the week. And please remain seated as we listen to the postlude. Thank you.
find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, your grace.